It was just past midnight, Eastern Time, on July 19th, 2024, when CrowdStrike, one of the world's largest and most trusted cybersecurity companies, released a routine update for one of their most used softwares. That routine update sent 8.5 million computers controlling air travel, healthcare, banking, stocks, restaurants, emails, and more into an endless loop of crashes that was felt around the world. The incident draws attention to the fragility of the tech ecosystems that run almost every aspect of our lives and their dependence on just a few very powerful companies. In this video, we look at how the CrowdStrike disaster happened and if we're really safe from it happening again. CrowdStrike is one of the largest cybersecurity companies in the world, holding the largest market share of any individual company in endpoint security at 23.8%. Since their founding in 2011, CrowdStrike has been involved in the investigations of a number of high-profile hacking cases, including Russian interference in the 2016 Democratic National Convention. CrowdStrike's core product is called Falcon, which includes automation, threat detection, endpoint security, and recently generative AI, among other things. CrowdStrike is huge. According to their website, they protect 298 of Fortune 500 companies, 43 US states, 8 out of the top 10 financial service firms, 6 out of the top 10 healthcare providers, and 8 out of the top 10 technology firms. In order to protect all of these companies from cyber attacks, CrowdStrike has to routinely update their software to protect against new potential threats. So on the morning of July 19th, CrowdStrike released an update to Falcon's sensor, modifying channel file 291 that caused an out-of-bounds memory read, which caused a boot loop, or basically an infinite series of blue screens of death on Windows computers. In order to work effectively, endpoint security softwares like Falcon Sensor have to be installed at the kernel level, which is basically the level of the operating system that goes before the user experience. This allows the software to protect against attacks without being vulnerable to malware or viruses. Falcon Sensor is privileged software, with deep admin access that can shut down any activities within the operating system that it thinks are suspicious. However, it also means that if something goes wrong, none of Windows security measures can stop it. The bad update was caught and reversed only about an hour and a half after being launched, but even in that time, 8.5 million Windows computers were affected, resulting in the largest IT outage in history. So what does that tangibly mean? Around the world, 5,078 flights were canceled, amounting to 4.6% of all flights scheduled that day, not including flights that were delayed or complicated by disruptions to reservations and check-in services. United, Delta, and American Airlines grounded all flights that weren't already in the air. Over one-fifth of all cancellations were in the United States. About 80% of those were Delta flights. Many passengers were forced to sleep on the floor in airports, as Delta struggled to recover over the next few days, canceling 1,400 flights on the 20th and 1,300 on the 21st. Delta revealed the software they used to track and distribute crew had been overwhelmed trying to recover from the system crashes and caused a staffing crisis. The next day, Delta canceled another 1,200 flights. On July 23rd, it was estimated over 500,000 people had been affected by Delta's cancellations alone, including unaccompanied minors stranded at airports for days at a time. Displaced passengers had trouble booking hotels or other accommodations because many of those services were also affected by the outage. Southwest Airlines was entirely unaffected, one theory being that Southwest still uses Windows 3.1, which was released in 1992, which is far too old to run CrowdStrike. In the financial sector, dozens of banks and financial institutions were affected, including Chase, Bank of America, Wells Fargo, Capital One, RBC, TD Bank, Visa, and more, preventing customers from accessing their accounts or receiving their salaries, among other things. NASA, the Department of Homeland Security, the National Nuclear Security Administration, and several other government agencies went down. 911 call centers across North America experienced outages or disruptions. Canadian child care benefit payments were delayed. Border services at the US-Canada border were delayed. The list goes on and on. One of the most concerning areas hit by the outage is healthcare. Hospitals in many countries lost access to patient records or couldn't use software that manages medical records, helps issue prescriptions, and makes appointments. Hospitals in the US and Canada paused non-urgent surgeries and visits and postponed procedures requiring anesthesia. In a post-COVID world where healthcare, particularly in Canada, is experiencing a worker shortage and is still trying to catch up for postponing elective surgeries during the pandemic, yet another disruption to healthcare goes far beyond an outage lasting a few days. Canadians are struggling to get a family doctor, or get appointments with said doctor if they have one, and adding further delays will have lasting ripple effects for months or longer. I could go on and on through retail, entertainment, media, etc., etc., but I think you get the point. The estimated cost of the outage is between $5 to $10 billion. So how could CrowdStrike, such a huge and respected company, have let this happen? First of all, users had no choice but to accept the update. There were no settings available to delay the installation of new updates, or accept updates when a user manually approves them. CrowdStrike has promised to add this feature, which would have prevented a significant portion of the disaster. Officially, they say that the update was pushed through because of a bug in the software that checks their updates for errors. CrowdStrike said that this was the first time this bug had happened and their checks were working earlier in the year, but reports have begun to trickle out, suggesting that might not be the case. After the July crash, users began reporting in online forums that CrowdStrike had been releasing broken updates for Linux computers for months. On three separate occasions, in April, May, and June of 2024, CrowdStrike software caused different Linux operating systems to crash. The event in April caused a Linux boot loop, similar to what happened in July. Although it's hard to know for sure, this series of bugs suggests that CrowdStrike's quality control issues go deeper than one update. And if they had done a better job of monitoring their software, this would never have happened. If a further investigation shows that CrowdStrike was negligent in this regard, it almost certainly will have a huge impact on their customer base and stock price. Linux only has about 4% of the market share in personal computing, in comparison to about 77% for Microsoft. A series of problems with Linux users would be easy to sweep under the rug, affecting a minuscule fraction of customers and not even being noticed by most of the world. The kicker is that the outage, really, was not that bad, all things considered. The update was distributed to most of the world in the middle of the night, meaning a large number of computers were off and not able to receive the update. It was caught after only about 80 minutes and then reversed. And the 8.5 million Windows computers affected are only about 1% of Windows computers worldwide. Fixing the problem will take weeks or months for some companies, as in most cases each individual computer needs to be booted into safe mode and the problem file deleted by hand. In an organization with hundreds of devices, this will understandably take time. Although Y2K is mostly a joke now, in the 1990s the threat of Y2K was the first major challenge of the information age, and a wake-up call that our reliance on technology made us better, stronger, and faster, but it also made us more vulnerable. In the years leading up to January 1st, 2000, IT professionals around the world put in the necessary work to ensure that we didn't experience grounded flights, disruptions to essential services, energy crises, and a host of other terrible events that could have occurred. While we learned from Y2K that we had to be aware of potential technological disasters, we have since become infinitely more dependent on that technology for everything. The fact that the largest IT outage in history didn't come from a hack or a cyber attack or an environmental disaster, but from a company tasked with protecting us from those things, is very indicative of the current state of capitalism. Although Microsoft is not at fault for the outage and over-reliance on two companies who have bought up or pushed out a long list of competitors, made everyone vulnerable to a small, entirely preventable mistake. There are largely two ways that things will change going forward. Either companies will stay with CrowdStrike, whose stock has dropped significantly since the incident, expecting that they will be extra vigilant to ensure this never happens again, or they'll choose one of CrowdStrike's competitors, likely the biggest one, who will then inherit their share of the market. If we are to be fully alarmist, we are all living on borrowed time when it comes to technology. Whether it be a cyber attack, another IT accident, war, environmental disasters, a runaway AI, or a solar magnetic storm that scientists say is destined to come somewhere between tomorrow and 200 years from now, our reliance on digital systems will someday backfire in an even more spectacular way. The issue is we don't have a tangible threat in front of us, like we did with Y2K, that would coordinate industry and governments towards a common goal. The potential danger is esoteric and, frankly, may never occur. But given the impact on individuals, businesses, and the economy, from 1% of Windows computers being affected, anything bigger could represent a fundamental change to how our world looks and how we live in it.